The following is brought to you by communication students at the University of Delaware.
Welcome to the second edition of Delaware Avenue. I'm Kristen Nutt.
And I'm Paul McAwee. Delaware Avenue is brought to you by the Communication Department at the University of Delaware in conjunction with the Winter Term Television Project. Tonight's program will feature a talk with Ken Burns, the man behind the scenes of the Civil War series.
And we'll also discuss the effects the ARA Corporation has had on the dining services program at the University of Delaware, as well as take a behind the scenes look at the university's number one radio station, WXDR.
We will begin tonight's program with a topic that has gained unfortunate popularity in the past decade. AIDS is a deadly disease that has struck many people, young and old, and the numbers are growing. Here's WTV reporter Tina Schaffery with more.
AIDS is one of the most serious health problems facing the American public in the 90s. It is important that we all understand this disease, regardless of who we are.
Hi, can I help you?
The state of Delaware offers an AIDS hotline so people can call up and have their questions about AIDS answered. John Barnes, director of the Delaware Lesbian and Gay Health Advocates, works to help give the community a better understanding about AIDS.
We have a number of education and outreach programs. Our broadest program is the toll-free statewide hotline, and the hotline number is 1-800-422-0429. I think that the public is still very ignorant about HIV and AIDS, and we're reminded of that by a lot of the hotline calls that we take, and we don't mind taking those calls. We want the opportunity to educate people, but a lot of the calls that come in are still very basic information. Can you get AIDS from a mosquito? Can you get AIDS from a toilet seat? That sort of thing. Magic Johnson, I think, has done the single largest education outreach to the heterosexual community. The responses seem to have died down a bit when he first made his announcement. We were flooded with calls on the hotline and people coming in for counseling and testing because they seemed to realize for the first time that what we had been telling them for the last 10 years was true, that they really are at risk of HIV.
No one is immune to this illness, that anytime you do any of the high-risk behaviors, whether it's unprotected sexual intercourse or whether it's sharing needles, the two main ways in which this disease is spreading, that you are susceptible to the virus.
Ann Lomax is the assistant director of the Student Health Service for Health Education at the University of Delaware. The health service offers education, counseling, and testing to the students.
If a student is concerned about any risk exposure, they're welcome to call and ask questions on the phone, too. I didn't mention that you don't need to give a name. You can just call and ask questions, and we'd be glad to answer those. The only person who can protect you is you yourself, that you can't rely on your partner to tell you the truth. And the only way you can be sure is either to practice safer sex or say no. Either say no for now, or no with you, or no until I feel that we are protected.
For more information, call the Delaware Hotline at 1-800-422-0429, or the National AIDS Hotline at 1-800-342-AIDS. This is Tina Schaffery reporting for WTV.
Violent crime also has been on the rise in society as a whole and has started to filtering down here to campus. And students must be aware of that.
Crime on campus. In a large school such as the University of Delaware, thefts, assaults, and attacks are bound to occur. The good news is that the university police have implemented programs to ensure the safety of its students.
One of the newer ones we just started was bicycle registration, mm-hmm. where students would come and register the bikes with us. We would issue them a sticker that would go on the frame of the bike, so if the bike is ever stolen or recovered, the sticker would be a certain identification number that people would see it, contact us, and then we could contact the owner. We offer programs in residence halls or to any other member of the university community for rape awareness. Go out, give them tips, let them know what they can do as individuals to help increase their security of themselves. We do not offer a self-defense course.
Fortunately, Carpenter Sports Building offers one-credit self-defense classes in which students learn techniques to defend themselves in case of an attack. It is important to be aware of where crimes commonly occur and how to prevent them.
Bikes are being stolen due to the fact that sometimes they're improperly secured or they're not secured at all, and therefore the individual comes back and finds their bike missing.
But what precautions are students taking to improve their own personal safety?
I don't walk alone at night, and if I do, I carry my mace or my rape whistle with me.
My dorm has a safe walk system, so like whenever we have classes at night, we walk with guys on our floor and stuff and make sure we don't go out after dark by ourselves.
Don't leave items in your car in plain view. One of the single most effective measures we have found for resident students is to lock the dormitory door.
Also, students should be sure to choose well-lit routes to follow if walking at night and try not to walk alone. Students should make use of the red phones located around campus in case of an emergency. If something looks suspicious or out of the ordinary, students should contact the University Department of Public Safety at 831-2222. Remember, together we can make the University of Delaware a safe place to go to school. For WTV, this is Lori Howard.
In the fall of 1991, students at the University of Delaware returned to find ARA services in charge of Delaware's dining facilities. ARA promised better service, more dining options, and overall improvements in the dining halls. Recently, I spoke with Randy Clay, district manager in residence, about some of the changes ARA made when they first arrived at U of D. Besides focusing on training and renovations, Clay told WTV about ARA's concern with nutrition.
We're all interested in nutrition, so we spent a great deal of time making item identifiers and labeling the nutrition content that goes into those so that when a student goes into any of our facilities and selects an item from the serving line, they know the fat content, they know the calorie content, they know what it is. We've done a great deal of that.
In addition, ARA also set up several committees to monitor its progress throughout the semester. How did students react to these changes?
We've had very positive reaction from the students. We survey our customers, we meet with them regularly, and the results that we've had in working with them have all been very positive.
University President David Rosell agrees, giving ARA high marks.
First term was just to get them here and get them established. And now from this point forward, you'll start seeing some renovation changes and you'll start seeing some changes in the menus and so forth. And we're very pleased with the current state of things and the way ARA has taken hold.
As for the future, ARA certainly has big plans to bring bigger and better services to U of D. For example, although ARA has their own brands such as It's a Pizza and Leghorns, Randy Clay told WTV about national brands which will soon be coming to the university.
This spring I'm bringing in the first nationally branded product, which is Dunkin' Donuts. I have several locations where we will be putting Dunkin' Donuts, and that first one is in Daugherty Hall.
Improvements students can see right away include the addition of the Quick and Simple Fare at the Blue and Gold Club. ARA also looks forward to the spring opening of Russell Dining Hall, which has, among other things, new carpeting, glass windows, and chairs and tables. However, even though ARA strives to solve any problems students may voice concerning the food at Delaware, Randy Clay admits it hasn't been easy. Yet he is confident about ARA's future at the university.
I think we're doing very well with it, and I certainly commend all of the individuals within the university, within dining services that were here, because they are warm, wonderful people, and we have the clients and the administration and the students here are good people to be around.
For WTV, this is Mort Schumann.
Today, most students see the Mall of the University of Delaware as the center of campus because of the many academic buildings and dormitories. But it wasn't until 1916 that construction began on the land that separated Delaware College from the Women's College. Wolf Hall was the first to be constructed in 1916. It was meant to accommodate the agriculture, biology, and chemistry departments for Delaware College. But it wasn't long after Wolf Hall was completed that construction of Memorial Hall began. Memorial Hall, which was completed in 1925, was the first building to be used jointly by both the men and women's college. Today, Wolf and Memorial Halls remain in the center of what has grown over the years into the University of Delaware as we know it today.
Few shows have had such a great impact on public television as Ken Burns' Civil War series. Recently, he returned home to Newark, and WTV reporter Paul Kennard was there to speak with him.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Ken Burns.
Ken Burns came home this January. Home for the award-winning producer and director of the public broadcasting system series, The Civil War, is Newark, where he and his brother Rick grew up. It seems that family is an important part of Burns' success. Among other things, he credits his grandmother for the spark that ignited the Civil War series.
My grandmother also told me tales from her youth that reminded me of how particularly potent the memory of the Civil War was, and that further convinced me.
In the series, Burns dramatically uses photos and anecdotes from those involved to weave through the four-year conflict from the beginning to end.
This army has never done such fighting as it will do now. We must conquer a piece. We will show the Yankees this time how we can fight. Private William Christian.
The Civil War was the central patch in the quilt that we call American history, in which all the threads are somehow connected to the others. They all are more connected to the Civil War than anything else, and in unsuspecting ways.
Although he considers the Civil War to be the closest America has come to a national suicide, Burns feels it is important to be aware of our past.
By investigating the 4 years, we find out not just about what happened back then, but who we are now.
Burns appeared at the University of Delaware bookstore to sign copies of the book that's meant as a companion to the series. The 45-minute signing attracted a crowd that wound throughout the store. Later that evening, Burns spoke at Newark Hall in front of a capacity audience. The publicity-shy producer threw in a quote from General Tecumseh Sherman in a dig at the media.
William Tecumseh Sherman hated newspapermen so much, he said he killed them all.
There would be news from hell before breakfast.
Burns said he looks at the past as an omen for the future.
History is an exercise in self-awareness, and it has its benefits now, in the present, not in the past.
Despite the comforts that the overwhelming success of the Civil War series has offered Burns, he has not slowed his busy schedule.
I've just finished a documentary called Empire of the Air about the men who made early radio, not just a sort of story of invention and genius, but a very dark story of greed and ambition and tragedy. And I'm also working on a series on the history of baseball and serving as an advisor in a history of the West and hoping to develop a series of single films, biographies of famous and not so famous Americans, which is a lot to do.
But no matter what path Ken Burns may decide to take in the future, he knows it's the past that's put him where he is now. For WTV, this is Paul Kennard.
St. Andrews, a private boarding school in Middletown, Delaware, features beautiful architecture and grounds, as well as a solid academic reputation. But what best distinguishes St. Andrews from other schools is that Peter Weir decided this was the place where he would direct Dead Poets Society.
It simply fit his needs. He wanted a school that was old in appearance. Now, St. Andrews is really not that old a school. We started open for business in 1930, which isn't that long ago, believe me. And yet the architecture here of this main building puts it back in time. It could be 200 years old. So he wanted that, and he wanted space around the school. He wanted it to be in the countryside. He wanted it to be an isolated area. And St. Andrews just fit all those physical needs of for the film.
Head groundskeeper Wally Williams suddenly found himself in great demand.
Another time it snowed, and they wanted to get a shot of the pier out here, but they didn't want any tracks from the school down to the dock down here. So we had to take them out on a barge, and the film crew and the director, Peter Weir, and so that they could film the bagpiper at the end of the T-dock down there with no tracks behind him, like he was standing there playing for quite a while. And we did things like this, you know, for him.
According to Hoover Sutton, a faculty member at St. Andrews, Dead Poets Society held a casting call to recruit extras.
All speaking parts, of course, had to be auditioned, and they brought in all the students, and they had to at least look at them on film, see how they looked, and so on. So everyone that was in the film had to be auditioned in some form or other.
But John Callahan managed to land a part without auditioning.
Well, at the time they were filming, I was delivering pizza in Newcastle. And I delivered a pizza to the set, and they said, go down and talk to casting. So I went down and talked to casting, and they signed me up.
Robin Williams portrays John Keating, an innovative teacher of English at Welton Academy.
We don't read and write poetry because it's cute. We read and write poetry because we are members of the human race, and the human race is filled with passion.
I was pretty amazed and struck at Robin Williams' timidness. He's a very shy individual, and he has to work very hard on the set to portray the kind of personality he has.
St. Andrew's School differs in many respects from its fictional counterpart, Welton Academy. Unlike Welton, St. Andrew's has been co-ed since 1973. But the chapel still conjures up images.
Whoever the guilty persons are, this is your only chance to avoid expulsion from this school.
Welton Academy, hello. Yes, yes, just a moment. Mr. Nolan, it's for you. It's God. He says we should have girls at Welton.
For WTV, this is Suzanne Marcus.
Do you know what the university's radio station is? Call letters and frequency?
Call letters and frequency? What's WXDR or something like that?
What is the frequency?
Yeah. No, I don't know. 98.7 something.
No, I have no idea.
91.5.
WXDR, and I don't know the frequency.
102.7?
WXDR, the University of Delaware's listener-supported non-commercial radio station, may not be well known by many students, but it certainly has a lot to offer. Station manager Chuck Tarver spoke to WTV about WXDR's goals.
Because we're a radio station, it's important that we serve the listening audience and our city of license, which is Newark. It's also important for us as a station located here at the University of Delaware to serve the University of Delaware.
WXDR originally started out as WHEN in 1968, airing only to students living in the dormitories. WDRB soon followed in the early 1970s. However, due to the desire to reach commuting students as well as the population surrounding Newark, WDRB soon became WXDR. With 1,000 watts of power, WXDR now reaches more people in more places. But how well known is the station? And do those who know of the station have any misperceptions? Scott Messing is the program director at WXDR.
I think that the station is not too well known by the students. I think maybe they've heard of us. Clearly, if you stand on the patio and look to the side of the building, it says WXDR in big silver letters.
Cassandra Lane, general manager, agrees, believing the station could be advertised on campus more.
I don't think the station's as well known as I'd like it to be. Right now we have a campaign with posters that were designed by a visual communications class that are going to be going up in the residence halls starting the beginning of spring semester.
As for its music, the station has many different styles to choose from.
WXDR works in a block format. We present different types of music, 2-3 hours a day, each type of music, from roots and classical and rap to progressive rock or modern rock, have you.
Okay, so WXDR offers something for everyone. But who exactly can get involved with the station?
Anyone can become a member. You don't have to be a student, or we have both students and community members.
As for the future of the area's only non-commercial station, Chuck Tarver told WTV that there is a push to increase the station's power, although there is a long road ahead.
We had a very nice proposal done for us by a firm in Washington, D.C., Cohen and DePell, who are our consultants. And what we ran up against was several competing proposals on 91.3, which would limit our options.
For WTV, this is Mort Schumann.
It will be a very attractive environment in which to play basketball, something that the university does not now have. Probably as importantly, it will be the location of administrative offices for athletics, the coaches' offices, locker rooms, strength training areas, so forth. It will be, among other things, the largest dining room in the state of Delaware. And we see trade shows and dinners and important convocations of all varieties taking place there. And we think it'll be a real asset, probably the most visited building in the state of Delaware before very long.
Now we'll hear from my co-host, Kristen, who recently went on location at the Wilmington Drama League.
The Wilmington Drama League, located here at 10 Westley Boulevard, has been bringing quality theater to the people of Delaware for well over 50 years. But with the upcoming performance, Children of a Lesser God, scheduled to open in late March, these talented performers plan on reaching out to their audience in a whole new way. Children of a Lesser God, written by Mark Medoff, has been staged thousands of times across the country and was also released as a feature film in 1986, garnering the lead actress an Oscar. It is an ideal production choice for a community theater such as the Wilmington Drama League because it offers a well-known title to attract audiences as well as challenging roles for the actors.
What happened here was that Helen Rolfe, my assistant director, brought me a script, and I fell in love with it.
Children of a Lesser God illustrates conflict between the hearing and non-hearing worlds through the relationship between James, a teacher in a deaf school, and his pupil Sarah. This subject matter has offered many unique challenges to both the cast and the crew.
You really had to make a long-time commitment to this show, because with a hearing-impaired cast and doing a show that's for the hearing-impaired and about the hearing-impaired, you obviously have to know sign language.
As a hearing person, I don't recognize that a deaf person needs to watch the person they're talking to. They either need to lip-read or they need to sign, and I'm used to having actors turn their backs on another actor and walk away and do, you know, and I ask Anne Marie to do that and she says, it looks at me like, all right, when are you going to wake up and realize this?
They're hard of hearing characters in the play and they're learning, they have speech impediments and yet the actors that are playing those two roles by nature, you know, as adults, as normal adults, they don't have speech impediments and they have to learn, it's almost like going backwards, they have to learn not to speak properly.
The lead role of Sarah is being played by Anne Marie Mickelson, who, like her character, has been deaf since birth.
Well, the emotional feeling of the character, to be so expressive, there's a lot of frustration that she feels trying to overcome the challenges of the hearing world. But I have had that experience myself growing up, so in theater, I can really identify with it.
Children of a Lesser God has meant far more to the actors, technical crew, and production staff than simply long rehearsal hours, memorized lines, and very complicated blocking. It has been a time to break stereotypes, open eyes, and learn several valuable lessons about the deaf culture.
People that are deaf and hard of hearing are often overlooked, and the perspective is always the hearing the hearing and the non-quote disabled community, but that we are the same. We are the same. We are equals to them. And that's very important for them to understand.
While emotions always run high on opening night, each individual has their own unique hopes and expectations.
My expectations for opening night, I'm going to be back here pacing like a lunatic.
I'd be lying if I didn't say I want a standing ovation. You know, that's what I want.
The importance to me would be that the audience feels the experience in becoming involved in the world of silence and realizing that the silence is beautiful. It can be beautiful. And that you can make your own music.
This is Kristen Nutt for WTV.
Probably the biggest thing that helped me weren't the bowls, were just the combine. The combine helped me the most. I mean, when you get an invite to the combine, that's the biggest honor you can receive. I mean, you get to go up against the best on a one-on-one basis, be tested and everything, and that's the biggest thing I'm looking forward to.
That's all for tonight's program. Tune in tomorrow when our co-anchors, Mort Schumann and Suzanne Marcus, will cover such topics as sexual harassment and the popular karaoke night at Klondike Kate's.
They'll also be taking an in-depth look at the plus-minus system recently implemented at the University of Delaware. Now, for Paul McAwee and the rest of the WTV staff, I'm Kristen Nutt. Good night.
Good night.
WTV 1992 would like to thank its local business sponsors, Newark Camera Shop at 63 East Main Street, Triangle Liquors at 104 North Chapel Street, Herman's Quality Meat Shop at 64 East Cleveland Avenue, The Down Under at 60 North College Avenue, Daffy Deli at 111 Elkton Road, The Cat's Eye Unisex Hair Salon at 144 East Main Street, and Margarita's Pizza at 134 East Main Street.